Second strategy, buying shares with limited risk. Now, we did have the question that that come through from Tony before. You could utilize this strategy not just to buy shares with limited risk. You could actually use this strategy to give yourself to supercharge your returns. And I'll touch on that at the very end for you, Tony. But we'll use this just to think about how we will be able to actually get some shares into our portfolio with limited risk. Now, we do have another question that come through. Actually, I've already answered that one. So buying calls for limited downside risk. We saw that when you already have shares in your portfolio, you can actually buy put options to protect our shares that we have in our portfolio. On the flip side, we can actually go and buy call options, provide us with the opportunity to buy shares, but not the risk of actually seeing the market fall significantly and our share price get clobbered because there's a surprise correction in the market. It's actually similar to when we think about it, buying now and paying later on consumer goods. We can go use Afterpay or Zip or whatever it might be. I pay a small amount today and I actually can actually get sent those goods today or buy them in store today and get the benefit of using those of those goods. We can actually go and buy call options today, get the benefit of share prices increasing. But if the share price doesn't increase, it doesn't give us a whole bunch of risk if the market falls significantly, because it allows us to make a small upfront payment, still gain all of those benefits because we have the right and not an obligation. If your stop picks wrong, you actually only lose the upfront payment. You lose the second payment out in the marketplace. So it actually can be really used well for stocks that we think are going to go up a lot, but we're just nervous because we're actually jumping around a little bit at the moment. And some of those stocks you would have seen most recently in the market being some of the buy now, pay later stocks. So Zip, Afterpay had some really strong run-ups into February and March this year, and they've come off a little bit now. There's a little bit nervousness around the market. There is risk in buying at really high levels in these particular underlyings. Is there a way via the options market that we can actually utilize options to help us get exposure to these shares, but not the risk of them potentially falling significantly? So we're going to have a look at that particular strategy. Question that's come through before I get there: when is the best time to sell an open position of a call option without owning the underlying shares? I might actually touch on that as we're going through this particular session, Leon, because I'm going to use 3-month options, so options that expire in 3 months. And I'll actually point out, if you don't actually want to own the shares in the future, when is the optimal time to sell? So we can actually go to the options market, and we're bullish on Zip. We know that Zip shares are trading at 7.25 at the moment. We did believe the shares that they could rally, but we're concerned. We saw that chart before. It's kind of had a good run up. It's come back. Is there potential for it actually falling further? So we're going to use 3-month options. So 90 days until expiry is September expiring option. Gives us enough time for our opinion on Zip to become true. Effectively, when we're buying call options, we're delaying the decision on when to buy the stock. We're delaying it out till September. Let the market pick whether we want to own the stock or not. Our price expectation is important, though. You don't just want the price to stay steady, because if the price stays steady and you buy options, you'll lose money. So we still need to be bullish, and we still need to have a price expectation that's above where the shares are trading at the moment. In this case, price expectation of 8.25, and our time frame for the opinion to come right, 3 months. So we consider purchasing a September $7.25 call. So let's have a look at how that might work in the market. So we buy the call. Let's say that call option actually costs us $1 to buy that call option. We have that strike price that we originally looked at, $7.25, pay $1 for that option. Unfortunately, all of a sudden, our break even goes up in value. So we're buying call options. I've got the wrong expiry date there. I do apologize. That should be September, not June on the screen. But our underlying security is Zip. So over the life of the option, what would happen over that life of the option? Let's say we held it all the way through to September. If the stock went up to $8.25, so it went from $7.25 to $8.25, the shares, we would have made a $1 profit on those shares. If the shares went up to $10, you would have made $2.75 on those shares. Stock gets back up to $14, which is where it was trading in March, February, March, just a few months ago, $6.75 profit on our shares. If the market corrects though, comes back to $5, you would have lost $2.25 on your shares. Come back further to $2, where it was trading prior to COVID, $5.25. If all of a sudden we look at the options market, how does that work in difference? If the stock doesn't move at all, so it remains at $7.25, our options would actually lose money because we paid a dollar for them. So we would have lost a dollar on that trade. That's where I'm saying you still need to be bullish on the market. If the stock rallies to $8.25, still didn't make anything out of options. But as the market starts to pick up and move forward, that's when we start to profit from the options market with a predetermined maximum loss of just $1. Doesn't matter how sharp far zip share price would fall, it's only going to cost us a dollar. We have the right, but not the obligation to purchase those shares. Back to Leon's question. If I didn't want to hold on right through until the September expiry, the way the options pricing work is over the life of the option, over the first half of the option's life, it loses only 1/3 of its value. But over the second half of the option's life, it actually loses 2/3 of its value. And that's that $1 value that we paid for that option. So I would suggest if you're buying a 3-month option and you don't actually want to own the underlying shares, at the end of 2 months, that's when to sell and close out of your open position, Leon, because you're then having time decay work in your favor. So if you actually don't want to own the shares, don't hold it all the way through to expiry, sell out a month early, and time decay isn't going to hurt you as much. If you buy call options on a $5 share price on expiry date, do you pay $5 or the difference between the option and the share price? So on the expiry date itself, we actually pay the strike price. So in this case, our strike price was $7.25. So we'd have to buy those shares at $7.25 if they were trading at $8.25, but it cost us a dollar up front for that options premium. So hence, we still pay the $7.25. You get a dollar appreciation out of the shares, but you lost a dollar on the options trade. So that's why we're still at a zero break even from that options perspective. Whatever your strike price is, that's what you pay at expiry. It isn't the difference in call options. Little bit different to index options where it's a cash transfer. Now, how would we utilize this trading strategy if we actually wanted to supercharge our returns? So we've got this $7.25 strike. So let's say we were actually thinking about going and buying 1,000 shares in Zip anyway. So that's going to cost us $7,250. We could just go and buy 10 options contracts. Gives us that 1,000 share exposure. And this trading strategy makes sure that the most we can lose is the dollar in premium per share that we paid up front. So it reduces our risk. If we want to supercharge those returns, rather than just buying 1,000 shares, those 10 contracts to give us 1,000 shares exposure, with a dollar premium, we could actually go and buy 70 options. Now, all of a sudden, we're exposed to a significantly higher amount of shares in that particular equation. Rather than 1,000 shares, we're now exposed to 7,000 shares. And now we get the benefit that if the market runs up, we can supercharge our returns. But that's much, much riskier because the risk now is we can lose everything that we've put into the option rather than just the $1,000 or the $1,000 in premium that we pay up front if we were just to do it on the original example I used. So we can use it to supercharge our returns, but obviously there's higher risk in doing that. Louise has asked a good question in how is the strike price set? I might actually stop sharing this screen for a moment, and I'll actually share a different screen, which is the one that that lots of brokers use in the marketplace. So just let me switch to a different screen. Bear with me one moment. So I'm hoping everyone can see this new screen that I've just put up at the moment. So we're just waiting for that next screen to pop up. Lots and lots of noise on this screen at the moment. It's actually showing the share market at the moment. But the screen that I've just expanded out is actually the options market screen. So if I go to ZIP as opposed to VUK, it will actually give us all of the options that are available on ZIP. And if we just look at the September options that we were looking at before, we actually have a whole range of different expiry dates that we can choose from in ZIP. So I chose that 7.25 option. If you wanted to, you could choose a $6.50 strike price. I could choose an $8 strike price, a $7.50 strike price. It's totally up to you which strike price you choose. The higher the strike price, the more the stock has to move up before you're going to profit though. So if you are a little bit more conservative, maybe pick a lower strike price, and that way there's more chance that that option will be worth value at the expiry date itself. It will actually increase in value. Someone's asked which is this platform. This is actually Iris. So many of the online brokers use Iris platforms as their premium products, but we can actually go to the options game and see it in there as well. On the option trading screen, how do you determine if it's a put or call option, if it's in the money, at the money, or out of the money? On my screen, you see at the moment, left-hand side are all call options, right-hand side are all put options. And the easiest way I can see that is in the expiry date, I can see little C's down the line here. And on the other side here, I have put options. What's in the money, at the money, or out of the money? At the moment, the last price for ZIP was $7.25. So the at-the-money strike is going to be $7.25 for a call option. All of the ones below that price will be in the money because they're in the money. If you exercise your right at $7, you're in the money by 25 cents. Out of the money are all the strikes above. For put options, just flip that on its head. So obviously, I want to sell above where the share price is. So the in-the-money is above and the out-of-the-money is below. Hopefully, that helped. Now, let me just get back to our presentation screen, and that's popped back now. So it really does help us if we start thinking about these different puts and calls. Puts we can use protection, calls we can use to get involved in a stock that actually limit our risk on our initial outlay, or in some cases you can supercharge return if you want to implement leverage for that trade. But importantly, when we buy a call, we pay the premium in full. We have a limited risk. The risk that you can only lose ever when you're buying an option is what you pay for that option. No one can ever ask for more money when you buy that option. But when it's a call option, there's a potentially unlimited reward. There's no limit as to how high the share price could go. Our break even is the strike price plus the premium. So $7.25 plus the dollar we needed the share price to get above, $8.25 in our example. So we're always going to be bullish when we're buying call options in the options market. Now, I want to be able to leave lots of time for you to ask questions. I'm happy to pop back to the IRS screen as well, but I just want to touch on first where you can go for some more information. Our plan is to host a lot more of these webinars, so please come back to us. What are some of the other sessions that you want to hear from us? Lots of people liked another strategy, which is selling calls over the stock they own, covered calls. We can touch that in other sessions. But if you do want to get more information around options, there's a whole host of free information on the ASX website, whether it's online courses. I've done lots of these webinar recordings before. You can access all of my past webinar recordings and even this one once we post that on the website as well. There's trading games, whether it's the share market trading game or the options trading game, which is currently trading, charting tools and calculators. So where do you go for that? asx.com.au/options, and you'll see a screen that kind of looks like that. At the moment, we actually have the options game up and running. So it actually started last week. So if you wanted to test out some of these trading strategies in market-like conditions, just with a bit of play money to see how the market works, optionsgame.com.au, and we've put up a $500 cash prize for whoever makes the most money over that period of time. It's a 4-week game. Generally, there's plenty of time with options if you use enough leverage to be able to make a decent profit out of that game anyway. Before I jump back to questions, there is another session on options immediately following this session run by the people that bring us the options trading game. It actually will look at how you can actually get ahead in this game itself, looking at how you take advantage of market movements and picking direction. So that actually starts in around about 10 minutes time. So there is time if you wanted to jump onto another webcast tonight. Go to reachmarkets.com.au and use that little link options game webcast, and you'll be able to dial into that session to maybe get some opportunities to get some ideas on directional movements. Whilst at the ASX, we can't give advice around options and the market itself. I know REITs markets do have advisors, so you might be able to get some tips in that particular session. When you buy an option, who makes the premium you have invested to buy that particular option? Really importantly, if you're using that particular option, who uses that money? It's the seller of that option. So it could be a person down the street that's got that option, or it could be anyone else in the marketplace. Generally, when you're trading in the options market, it's actually a market maker that is providing liquidity into the options market. We actually have some webcasts on the ASX site to give you an understanding of how market makers work and how they trade in the market and hedge their risk. But I'm more than happy to hold one of those sessions again. Thank you very much for your time this evening. I'm going to stick around for the next 10 or 15 minutes to be able to answer questions. I might even jump back to that live trading screen, even though we don't have a market up and running at the moment, just if any questions come through around the market at the moment as well. But thank you very much for your time this evening. Stick around for the next 10 or 15 minutes and answer any and every question that you may have on the market. How much do the average broker charge to write an option? So if you're going to the options market to buy options, I think for an online broker, the average charge is around $25 for an options trade. Full service brokers, very similar charges to what they charge for equities. I think the minimum for full service or advice brokers these days is around $100 a trade, or a percentage of the shares that you're purchasing. With options, that's based off of the premium that you pay. So you're paying a percentage on your premium. How can I tell if it's American or a European style option? Now, it depends on your broker's screens, and this is where it becomes a little bit difficult, but this ZIP stock that I have, if we look over on the left-hand side, we can see ZIP IL7. It has an E next to it. That means it's a European style option. All of the ones with an A next to the code are all American style options, and then a ZIP LF7 has an E next to it. So we can actually tell then whether it's an American or European style option. On the ASX website, you can simply click on the options code and it will pop up and tell you the exercise style of that option, whether it's an American or a European. Just question, do brokers provide this platform? Ask your broker. Lots of brokers use Iress as their platform. They might call it something different. I know ComSec, for instance, calls it ComSec Iress, but it's definitely a platform that is readily available from many brokers out in the markets. The options game uses a different platform to this, however, but please feel free to ask your broker, and they'll let you know how you'll be able to see any of those screens. We had Leon ask that question again. Oh, sorry, but it's come down. So not many more questions coming through at the moment, but please feel free to flick them on the screen. If you at all wanted to see where all the activity was happening in an options market, lots of brokers, and I know our website as well, has the full list of option stocks and all the volume that goes through in that market. So the screen that I'm expanding now just shows the summary of trading that actually happened in the options market today. So we can see Lend-Lease options were the highest traded options today, with almost 86,000 contracts trading. So that's 100 shares per contract. So a whole bunch of value going through in that market. $103 million worth of options changed hands in Lend-Lease today. So very active stock. Generally, the ones that are always up the top in the options markets, not normally a Lend-Lease. You'll see a Fortescue, a Commonwealth Bank, and XJO in the index are generally always up in the top three underlyings that trade in the options market. Why American options seem to be less risk? It's not about risk, I guess, from American options perspective. It's just that if I buy that option, I have the right to exercise on any day that I want. So I said that when you buy options, you don't get dividends. The only way you can get a dividend is exercise your right before the stock goes ex-dividend and you own the stock. You can only do that with American style options. European style options, you can only exercise on the expiry date. So a lot of people that buy options tend towards American style options because it gives them more choice. What does the settle column show? So, under a lot of options, the settlement is actually the settlement price of the option itself. So you can see that because the market's now closed, there's no buyers and sellers in the market at all. There's no volume because the market's closed. But if you wanted to get an idea of the value of that option, go to the settle column, and it's actually what we valued at the ASX, what that option was worth at the end of the day. So that $7.25 option that we looked at before, it was valued this evening at $1.05. So my idea of a dollar, I was almost pretty much spot on the mark. So $1.05 and half a cent was what that option was worth at the end of the day. It just gives you an understanding of where we valued those options. An example on RNU. So I might have given everyone a we're focusing on exchange traded options in this section, and someone said that there was actually an option over a stock code RNU. I might actually bring up a different depth screen to give everyone an understanding of that. So RNU is the stock, and we can see it's Renascor is the underlying stock itself, but the company has actually issued options. They are call options only when company options are listed. And they have an expiry date of the 31st of December 2022 in this particular case. That is the options that's trading there. So it's actually a company issued option there, Andrea, as opposed to an exchange traded option. Very different to the ones we spoke about today because they will only ever be call options when it comes to company options. Someone's asked a question, is it fair to say the options market is an indication? Bear with me, more questions coming through. Is an indicator of where people think the market is going as the number of options either put or call. It is a fair indication if everyone was going the same way when they purchased those options. So we have this thing that we put it out in our statistics, which is basically the put call ratio. So how many puts are being traded as opposed to calls? You'd expect that the more puts that are trading compared to calls means the market has a tilt towards it falling in value. But that's assuming that everyone is buying options as opposed to lots of people come into the market to sell options. So if you go to the ASX website under our statistics section for the options market, we actually give you a clear indication of whether clients are net buying or selling options. That's a much better indication. So if people are net buying calls, it means that the market thinks it's going up. If people are net buying puts, it thinks that the market is actually going down. So good thought there, Lee. In selling calls, can you do this without owning shares, i.e. naked calls? John, I would actually suggest not to do that strategy. The risk that you have there of selling calls over stock that you don't own is if this stock goes up significantly in value. You don't own the shares, you're going to have to go and purchase those shares in the open market to sell back to someone at a much lower price. So let's say you sold $20 call options and the stock rallies to $35. You're going to have to pay $35 just to sell it for a stock, just to sell it back at $20. And all you earned from that was the options premium. And it could be as little as a dollar. So it's cost you 15 bucks to make a buck. I would generally, especially starting out, only ever sell calls over stock that you own or the stock that you purchase at the same time. Leon, another question. How do you calculate the value of the option? Is there a formulation? We tend not to go through that formulation in an intro presentation. I think there's mathematic degrees that are around it. There's two models that we use in Australia. One's called Black and Scholes, the other one, the binomial model. What we might do is I might do an options pricing session as another webinar, Leon. But effectively, there's two parts that make up an options price. There's notional value and time value. The notional value of an option is how much it's in the money. So if we have a $10 share price and a $7.50 call option, it's $2.50 in the money. So that would be one component of what you'd have to pay for the option value. But then there's time value, and time value is impacted by interest rates, expected dividends, by the volatility of how much a stock might jump around, and that will impact on how much extra you have to pay over and above notional value. Some options that are out of the money only have time value. And it's using those models of Black and Scholes for European style options and binomial for American style options that helps us in trying to determine what a fair value of that particular option may be. Your brokers will have calculators, and I know this system itself has a calculator as well. So if I was to click on that option that we were looking at before, and I go to the options calculator, option valuation here, embedded behind this chart that I'm looking at here is actually the binomial model that will be helping me in determining the value of that particular option, dependent on some variables. Someone's asked a really good question, something that we wouldn't normally cover in an introductory session. Could you use a cap and collar nil cost strategy? If so, what extra conditions apply? So this would be where you're buying puts just to protect yourself against the market falling, and then selling calls above where the market's trading. That would be on stock that you're owning. So it effectively has a zero cost from that perspective. If you were to do it in selling call options, you would need to go and buy other call options above where the market's trading to be able to protect yourself from a significant run-up, and then hold the cash as the difference. That could work in that particular case, Peter. What happens if an option seller defaults? That's the really beauty about being in an exchange. That's effectively what we do at the ASX. We become the seller to every buyer and the buyer to every seller. So whenever you buy an option from someone else, at the end of the day, ASX steps in between that trade. And if the option seller defaults, we take on that obligation to you as the buyer of the options contract. We become your creditor as the stock exchange itself. The reason we can do that is the sellers of options, we make sure that they're paying margins, and it's margins that reflective of the risk that they're holding and their obligations to the market. So even if the seller defaults, your counterparty in those cases in exchange markets is actually the ASX, not the counterparty to that trade. Can you find the stop price on a company issued option on ASX? Generally, a company issued option, if you want to know what the stop price is, just use the first three letters of the company option itself. So that RNUOB that we looked at before, RNU was the company was the company details. You can just type in RNU and it will give you the actual code itself. Is it best to buy an option over a volatile share like Afterpay, or is it best to buy more conservative share like Rio? It really depends on where you think the market's going to rally to, Frank. There's more likelihood that Afterpay is going to jump around because of the volatility in the stock, but you're going to have to pay more for that option. Whereas something that's less volatile will mean that you don't pay as much for the option, so you don't need to make it move as much. So I either can work in your way, but you just have to be conscious that there's higher risk in trading in higher volatility stocks. Some really good questions coming through. One of the questions that come through, when the capital gain is on a stock, is selling a call anticipating a correction as a good short-term strategy? Most definitely, if you have a target, and this is what institutional, so the super funds will do it all the time. They have a target price for a share, and they will sell call options at that target price for a short-term gain on the stock and make a capital gain. On the flip side, on a stock that they want to pick up in their portfolio, they'll actually sell puts to try and pick up that stock a little bit below where they've got a target price to buy those particular shares. So it's definitely a strategy that institutions utilize. You just need to be of the mindset that you're happy to let that stock go, John. That's the most important thing when you're selling call options and covered calls. You need to be comfortable in being able to let go of that stock. because it can get expensive. You're having to buy those options back. Another person asked about rolling options. If you're rolling an option, effectively, it's closing out of your current position. So with that zip equation, we were long calls. If I wanted to extend the time frame over which I want to have that long exposure in zip, I can sell my shorter dated call options and buy some longer dated call options. So if we're approaching expiry in September, I might want to roll out my exposure to December. So I sell out of my September options, I buy a December option. That would be rolling that option. And Neil's just jumped in now. Yeah, we have recorded this session, Neil. So yes, please come back. We should have the recording by the end of the week on the ASX website. So please feel free to pop back for that recording. It's now gone past 8 o'clock. Lots of you have still stuck around. So thank you. Thank you for time. If you do want to ask further questions, you can simply send an email to options@asx.com.au. And we're more than happy to answer your questions as a result of that, as a result of today's session. If you're listening to this recording, similarly, just send your questions through to options@asx.com.au. We would be more than happy to answer your questions. But thank you all very much again for your time this evening, and hope to see you online again for one of our webinars in the near future. Thank you. Thank you.